top of the morning to your pizza. You smoothie me, ice cold pizza, cafe ole, latte da. You do the Zumba, but I do not. Give me like half a marathon. I'll give you the gospel of St. John. Hits me like a wake up bomb. Cause we both know that it's mercy flows in the morning.
You know, lots of times we make assumptions or presume things that are correct or incorrect based upon inaccurate information. That we're only given a certain amount of detail, and then we make assessments based upon those facts that we're given and then come to a conclusion. Or at least that's the way it's supposed to work. Now, what most people do is they just presume and assume. Now, at times, we all make mistakes. If you're consistently being confronted by mistakes that you're making, then you're a person who's error-prone or subject to maybe gossip or incorrect identification of facts. Some people would say lying, but not everyone has an attitude of directly being accountable for their words. God said that every idle word that we speak. Now, it's interesting is that we have an assumption in America that somehow it's okay to just shoot off your mouth, have freedom of speech, and you can speak with impunity, meaning that there's no consequence to your words. Or a lot of times people would use the idea that actions speak louder than words. That's not true in God's case. God says, look, every idle word will be held accountable. He's recording or making and paying attention to everything you say and not paying so close attention to what you do, because he knows what you do and you make doo-doo. But what you say, those are the things that will justify you and those are the things that will condemn you. For out of your mouth should come blessings and honor and glory and praise unto our God daily. But if you added up the number of idle words that you have, are you actually spending the time to monitor your mouth, to watch what you say, to pay attention to what you are speaking? Maybe it's time to think about that. Maybe it's time to balance the ledgers or the scales and put more positive, you know, encouraging words in the column that is godly of your nature than the column that, quite frankly, reveals your ungodly nature. Each one of us, we ought to do that. Each one of us don't always do that, and sometimes we fail miserably. And when we do, we have an advocate with the Father, even Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, who has saved us from our sins and the consequence and penalty of death, but that doesn't allow us in grace to go about doing and, you know, slapping people in the face or going about, you know, making false accusations or false witness or testimonies that aren't true. As a matter of fact, the Bible says liars lie and they do not inherit the kingdom of God. Murderers or those that speak falsehood or those that speak untruth also fall into the same category. We all have to stand before Jesus one day. We all have to give an account for our lives. We all have to recognize that we're not righteous and that one day we will pay for, in some way, what we've done, or in a lot of ways receive reward or just compensation for what we have said with our tongue, that is the unwieldy member that the the Bible describes for us as being something that we need to curtail. So a lot of times, you know, I find myself, you know, making mistakes in conversation or making mistakes in postings or making mistakes that I simply turn to God and say, hey, God, forgive me, and move right on and laugh about it. I think it's funny. As a matter of fact, more often than not, when I do make a mistake, I think it's funny. Now, I remember a recent history just less than a year ago where I made a mistake. You know, I mean, I'm older, I'm an elder, you know, I've been in just about every office in the church, you know, at some point in time for some capacity. I've been a missionary at large for a long time. I've been called by Jesus as a preacher. And so I don't have a problem saying, hey, I make mistakes. I am a sinner. You know, I sin too. And by the way, you know, I also am the worst and the least of his servants and the worst of, you know, those that have been saved in the sense that I need grace more than everyone else. But at the same time, I have no problem that if God says, I'll do. And that if Jesus leads, I'll follow through. Because that's what God does in me by the Spirit of God. It isn't I that liveth, but Jesus that lives in me by his Spirit. For in him we live and move and have our being, and without him we could do nothing. So the reality of sometimes living out our lives in everyday circumstances challenges people because we don't identify the power behind the throne. We don't identify the problem behind the situation. We don't look at and recognize that we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and spiritual wickedness in high places. But also in one other way, we do wrestle against flesh and blood, our own. And we must beat down our body, as it were, not build it up and, you know, buff it up and beautify it, because our body is disgusting. It's gross. It's carnal. It's, as a matter of fact, if you're into yourself, you're losing yourself and will probably not recognize that you're not saved because you didn't deny yourself. If you are all into what your looks are and your appearances, then I got news for you. That's not what Jesus sees. He doesn't look on the outward things, but he looks on the heart. So if you want to beautify something or you want to change something or make something better, control your mouth. Because out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. And so whatever's inside is what comes outside. So you need to put inside more of what needs to be beautified than really trying to clean up your act on the outside and fake it when really God knows what the inside is all about. You need to not only make your bed and sleep in it, but you need to treat yourself as the example of the grace of God being worked out in you so that without you, all about you, throughout you, God can use his demonstration of forgiveness, of mercy, and of kindness towards one another so that we would all enter into the kingdom of heaven. A God of truth and without iniquity, just and right is he. Him that judges righteously. We must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that every one may receive the things done in his body, according to that which he has done, whether it be good or bad. Every one of us shall give an account of himself to God. The soul that sinneth, oh yes, it shall die. Awake, O sword, against my shepherd, against the man that is my fellow, saith the Lord of hosts. Smite the shepherd. The Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. Mercy and truth are met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. Mercy rejoices against judgment. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. A just God and a Savior, there is none beside me, just and the justifier of him that believeth in Jesus, justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. So let us go forward today and throughout the weekend and throughout the day and throughout whatever time frame you find yourself in to trust in the Lord with all thy heart. Lean not to thine own understanding, but in all thy ways acknowledge him. He shall direct your path, and control your mouth. control your tongue. Examine the words to make sure they're what you want to say when you want to say something to God.
TV, the lights, camera, the action, a smoke screen. But the truth that lies underneath is opposing the God that we say we need. Don't be so easily misguided by the clever schemes and disguises. Look a little deeper and you will discover reflection of another. Jesus is a keeper. The face value is only an illusion, but the knowledge of reality's delusion. Help me form my ultimate conclusion. No more following and listening to what they say. They're not the real authority anyway. Look a little deeper and you will discover reflection of another. Jesus is the keeper.
Oh.